So I think the Abbott India, Vijay Kuthia, who has taken lead and he has given us a grant to run this webinar. So we are going to have a practical look at EWR. We have two excellent speakers from our society, and Dr. Vikas is going to moderate us. So Dr. Vikas Singhal, please go on.
Thank you, sir. So good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining in. So we really have some very interesting talks today evening. So the topic for today is a practical approach to abdominal wall reconstruction, or AWR. So to set the stage or the background for today evening, I had to go back and read up on, refresh myself that what really is AWR, or abdominal wall reconstruction, and how is it different from routine hernia surgeries that we all do. I could not find one single definition of abdominal wall reconstruction or AWR. And what I realized that it is more of a concept that, this concept is that we need to try to restore the anatomy and restore the function. This comes about from a realization that the abdominal wall is not just a solid wall, it's really a dynamic organ that contributes a lot to our daily bodily functions. And if the abdominal wall anatomy and function is impaired, like in large hernias, it can really impair the quality of life of our patients. So it's not just about, operating to fix a hernia, it's about restoring the anatomy and the function as far as possible, so we can try to optimize the outcome for our patient. So hence this, almost a niche area has gradually come about, abdominal wall reconstruction, almost a specialty of its own, where we are trying to do that, and newer techniques have come up. Various techniques, especially for large hernias, we often require the help of component separation surgeries, like the anterior component that was being done, and then the posterior component or the TAR procedure that came about. Over time, a lot of newer procedures have been started, have come into vogue, that are now being done for abdominal wall reconstruction. So there is not one way, for a given situation, for a given patient, one could argue like what happens, or I should say debate, like what happens in our hernia groups. And it's a very exciting debate where, somebody may recommend one procedure, somebody may recommend another. So what really is the best way, or what really, how should we go about it? So that is what we are here to, discuss, or, two great talks today that would help us decide that, what really would be a practical approach to abdominal wall reconstruction, AWR. AWR, the complex procedures also come with their set of complications, which are unique complications sometimes. So we have to really judge what would be an appropriate procedure based on various factors. The patient factor, the anatomy of the patient, and of course our own skill set. So all those things would go into account. So without, taking more time, I would just give you a brief outline. Firstly, we have a talk by Dr. Pramod Shinde on what do pilots and surgeons have in common. So we are really looking forward to that talk. And sir's talk would be followed by a talk by Dr. Aparna Deshpande, ma'am, on the practical approach to AWR through case scenarios. So she would be going through clinical case scenarios. This would be followed by a question and answer session for 15-20 minutes. So please post your questions in the chat box so we can, go through the questions, and, quiz our speakers and the other AWR community towards the end of the discussion. So, you know, I would like to invite Dr. Shinde, sir, to please share his screen. And while he's doing that, I'll just give a brief introduction of Dr. Shinde, who really does not need a formal introduction in the world of AWR, you know, because he's been such a prominent figure doing AWR. But, you know, for those of you who don't know him, he's been in surgical practice for over 35 years. He's been a pioneer in laparoscopic surgery right from the onset. You know, I believe in 1990s, he started laparoscopy in Northern Maharashtra. And he, you know, he has this amazing zeal to learn new procedures, new technologies, and adapt and perform them. And I'm continuously amazed by, you know, his zeal to learn and then subsequently teach those procedures. He, apart from being, you know, of course, a very experienced surgeon, is also a great musician and one of the most humble surgeons I know. So I request Dr. Shinde to please deliver us his talk on what do pilots and surgeons have in common. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas, for the kind words, the nice introduction. And I must thank the Abdominal Wall Reconstruction Surgeons community for holding this event and inviting me as one of the speakers. I must thank Abbott for having helped and given a grant for this kind of activity. Their products are well known and all of us have been using them. Some of their ranges are pretty well known all over. I must thank Dr. Ramesh Punjani for having suggested a novel topic. Of course, today's talk, as Vikas was saying, the whole focus was on practical aspects of abdominal wall reconstruction surgery. But I am afraid that this talk may veer towards being less practical and more philosophical. But I am not worried because I have Dr. Aparna Deshpande to take over after me and fill in any gaps and compensate for a pretty non-practical approach to abdominal wall reconstruction surgeons community. I believe personally that philosophy has a very big role in our lives, whether we realize or not, whether we follow it consciously or not. And I love it and I'm a great student of it. I'm not a guru, but I'm a student of philosophy and surgery and many other subjects that life and time can allow, and I wish I had more moments to do that. So to start with this talk, what do pilots and surgeons have in common? Well, this title itself brings two images to my mind. One of them is obviously Dr. Atul Gawande. The Checklist Manifesto is a very famous bestseller, and this has changed the world of surgery. The checklist that he investigated and did a large multicentric trial as the checklist which all surgeons across the world to follow brought about a reduction in the complication rates in the surgical field all over the world by more than 37%. And after that, this list has been adopted all over the world and all of us are following to a larger extent, some to a fewer extent. And apart from this list, this has really led to many other things in surgery based on this philosophy of having a very protocol-based checklist kind of approach to minimize the errors and also reduce complications. Not only that, to improve the quality of our surgical practice and ultimately improve the patient's outcomes. So I don't need to talk much about this concept and Dr. Atul Gawande because he is a household name to all surgeons and this list is very commonly being used. The other name that came to my mind, I don't know whether everybody recognizes this or not, but this is Captain Sully. Chesley Sullenberger, who became a very famous pilot when almost more than a decade ago, he faced a major situation in his airplane and had both his engines fail and had to land in the River Hudson. I don't know how many of you have seen the movie. If it was a live offsite event, I would have seen your hands go up or go down. We must thank director Clint Eastwood and the entire crew for an excellent movie like this. So here we can see that the pilot did not have time to instruct his crew members for the seat belts, but they took on the challenges. And there was an absolutely unspoken communication between all the team. They did not have enough time to consult anyone. But the crew on the ground, definitely the person who was handling it, he immediately called for help. The first moment when he heard that this plane's engines were down, he immediately called Sue for help. They tried to recruit other people for help. And later on, hundreds of people and ships flocked there to save all those 155 people aboard. So the question is, how does this relate to our surgery, AWR surgery? Well, there have been number of papers published on this. And in fact, one of the chapters holds this very title written by R. Latifi. It says that pilots undergo intensive training in order to fly commercially or privately. However, this training cannot predict who will commit errors or who will be able to handle emergency situations effectively. Here, Captain Sully was able to do it. A key component is extensive training, and so that when an emergency occurs, he or she does not have to think about the basic procedures for their job. Instead, the pilot is able to focus solely on the current emergency and how to handle it. Performing a complex surgery is much like flying a plane. Both take enormous amount of training and at times can be grueling. Surgery itself can be dangerous. We all know that. It's time pressured. Okay, and while much of it depends on the technical skills of the surgeon, there are other factors and non-technical elements have a major effect and are required to effectively execute an operation. These words have been written by R. Latifi in a book titled Surgical Decision Making. Again, looking at the pilot side, one of the pilots interview on Google reads that he says that pilots have to learn so much, their ATPL stuff, the systems of your aircraft, including how to use performance graphs, airplane limitations, including many engine limit numbers, aircraft flight manuals, operating data manuals are the things that you should know like the back of your hand. You also need to know very well the SOPs of the airline, emergency procedures, operation of not only the aircraft, but also every single emergency equipment on board. On top of all that, every 6 months, you need to successfully complete a pilot proficiency check, just like our CMEs and credit points, a simulator check, and every year you need to complete a line check. This is very hard work, and most airline pilots are now extremely knowledgeable and educated people. Almost science like what we do in our routine practice. So we, looking at all this, and we also intuitively know that pilots and surgeons both need to train very well in their equipment, operations, science and art of performance of surgery, and the terrain of operations, not just the operation technique. Take responsibility of all aspects of lives of people who are under our care. Both need to be meticulous in following all protocols, rules, guidelines, and take no shortcuts. Prepare and train themselves to handle any and every emergency that may arise. Both have to be a team leader and have to have rapport with their teams. They must polish their communication skills, learn to use precise, effective, and respectful words, and continue to learn, grow, and become better at all aspects, your craft and yourself. So, taking this first commonality, the need to train very well in their equipment, operations, science of performance of surgery, and the terrain of operations. We also train ourselves in our AWRS surgery. This is what we are, why we are together. The AWRSC has been formed on this very premise of spreading the knowledge and training. And the common avenues are workshops, YouTube, social media, training programs, in operation theater observations, short duration observations with a mentor, fellowship in a high volume center, and of course, self-training continues lifelong. But do our training avenues suffice? There are many papers on this, and this was an evaluation of a long-term impact of education. This was from Brazil, and this was, although a small study, it is similar to some of the less progressive countries, where they also found that although 88% adopted their techniques, there were many who felt that they needed another course and were not able to use it. So their conclusion was that we need to develop new forms to help these students become proficient and perform steps. Besides, the study showed that we must have a valuable initiative like the one that they had to build a sustainable hernia program in their communities. So not all training programs are sufficient to take up this on a very big major way. Again, there are, out of so many papers, this one actually investigated and found that the online information on TEP is of suboptimal quality. And although limited information is available on preoperative and postoperative processes, and a site like WebSearch has got a great educational potential, but still it may not be sufficient to train surgeons on complex procedures. Again, development and validation of checklists for assessing recorded performances. So surgeons doing TAPP, their performances were recorded and analyzed as to who was performing better. And they found that there was a significant difference among surgeons performing more than 50 taps versus surgeons performing less than 10 taps, a new surgeon. And this also shows that TAP checklist via video monitoring or mentoring is a valid metric for assessment of the recorded TAP performance. And this can be correlated with all our AWR procedures also. Again, in a very advanced country like Japan, which is known for their very high surgical skills, this paper has come up in 2017, which says that proper training and laparoscopic hernia repair is necessary to minimize rising recurrence rates in Japan. Mind you, Japan is talking about this. And in this paper, they found that the high recurrence rate after inguinal hernia repair in Japan was mainly due to inadequate training in the laparoscopic method. And obviously, the laparoscopic hernia repair training can achieve a lower recurrence rates. Many of the registries, like the Danish hernia registry, also has shown similar figures. So is our training in abdominal wall reconstruction surgery competency based? Is it adequate? Is it comprehensive? Is it sufficient? I think we need to ask ourselves these questions. And although abdominal wall reconstruction surgeons community is working full time on training, sharing, elevating the standards of care of surgeons and patients alike, this is a big time job and all of us are in it together. And this is not two or three or four or five people's job. All of us have to take this up as one of our prime mottos, not only train ourselves, but train our colleagues besides us, around us, and across the country. The second commonality that we can see is that pilots and surgeons take responsibility of all aspects of lives of people, not just their life, but even any injury or any other part of their well-being. So they take responsibility of all aspects of lives of people who are under their care. So this paper really discussed when is the burden of responsibility over for surgeon, because we all know that we have a high when we perform a surgery in the operation theater. But our responsibility doesn't start in the operation theater and doesn't end it. And this paper found that there is clearly an unmet need for post-operative care. And like many journeys, the burden of post-operative care seems to extend to the horizon. This study again further emphasized that there is a need for further emphasis. Again, surgeons' responsibility for patient's care. And there are many papers on this. So as AWR surgeons, we know that it's not just the post-operative care, but the care starts right from the outpatient evaluation of a patient, classifying the patient, getting him investigated, prehabilitation, getting him pre-optimized, operating on him, doing a follow-up, managing all the complications and keeping a record and a follow-up and looking at him, how is he doing for the rest of his life. Again, this paper published in 2016 says that in addition to appropriate technical skills, surgeons must also possess the clinical acumen to provide appropriate perioperative care for complex abdominal wall reconstruction patients. Okay, obviously prehabilitation precedes surgery, and sometimes a patient may not be ready for surgery several months after their initial consultation because pre-optimization and prehabilitation is also equally important. The third commonality that we can see is we need to be meticulous in following all protocols, rules, guidelines, and take no shortcuts. Well, preparation is the only shortcut that you need in surgery. That means that this paper says that there is no shortcut apart from preparation. Preoperative checklist of WHO, the one that Atul Gawande developed, has saved millions of patients from complications. But, and we all know that it has got a great impact on the patient's safety because the implementation of checklist shows improved outcomes. And I know that this checklist is followed in corporate hospitals, but do we follow it in our own private practice, in our own nursing homes, in our own life? Again, we know that the World Health Organization checklist improves post-operative outcomes, and there's a meta-analysis, systemic analysis. Almost 50,000 patients have been studied, and this does lead to significant reduction in complication rates and mortality. But obviously, one surgical checklist does not fit all. We also need to develop a checklist apart from the one that WHO has for pre-op checklist for AWR surgeries. And even a primitive one can make a difference, but obviously we need to go a long way in that. A simple decision prop, like, is this a simple or a complex hernia? Is the patient fit or compromised? Is the defect routine or large? Does this patient have a loss of domain? Will this patient need abdominal wall reconstruction or a simple procedure? What surgery? What mesh? What cost? What post-op complications are expected? This we need to have planned, anticipated before even we take up the patient for or give him a date for surgery. And again, on a personal level, we must also have a checklist to check whether we have the skills for the surgery. I must ask that, do I have the skills for this surgery? Do I have the training to perform this procedure? Does my hospital have the infrastructure to support this patient and patient? Do I have the authority status to handle the social implications if there are any complications? Since if I'm a junior person, I may not have enough authority to be able to handle the high pressure situation that a complication or a mortality might create in a patient. The other commonality that we could see is that both pilots and surgeons prepare and train themselves to handle any and every emergency that may arise. A near miss is an event that could have resulted in adverse consequences but did not. I think we face this many times. There are so many near misses that we must have experienced in a lifetime. An adverse event is in a lesser degree, describes an error which results in some degree of patient harm. So it's a complication. At almost every point in his career, almost all of us would be involved in a very serious adverse effect, and that we are all at risk of experiencing strong emotional reactions. The natural response to crisis is physiological. We all know tachycardia, stress hormones, shallow breathing, pupillary changes. Psychologically, the first response could be freezing. Almost all of us can freeze when there is a huge bleeder which bursts in our face. Then there is a denial. We all tend to see that this isn't happening. Our mind says that, well, this is not happening to me. And then there is panic. There's loss of situational awareness, loss of reasoning, loss of judgment. And this is why whenever there is a crisis, we need help. We need a team. We need to call for help. We need a team which can support us. We need previous training. And as we have seen in the previous paper, an absolute anticipation and training can help us avert or minimize this kind of a response so that we will be able to deal with a complication very effectively. So how do we avoid this kind of panic response to crisis? We can't avoid it totally, but obviously a key component is extensive training so that we don't have to even think about the basic procedure required for handling it. Instead, this is how we've already seen that. This was by Latifi again in the same book, Surgical Decision Making. We must operate with a team which knows what to do in an emergency and will not freeze with us. We must set protocols beforehand for handling emergencies so that everybody knows what is to be done, like what we saw Captain Sully do it. Anticipation and talking about it. There are complex surgeries where we could anticipate certain complications. We can discuss amongst our team, warn our team members, our operation theater staff, our assistants, our anesthetists that this complication can happen, so everybody is prepared for it. And discussing the possibility with the patient and relatives beforehand and taking consent. If we have discussed with the patient the probability of a complication, then we will be much more at peace and we will be much better able to handle this because we know that we've taken a consent for conversion to open, we have taken a consent for aborting, we have taken a consent, and we, the relatives, these kind of complications can happen. This is one common way in which we handle bleeding. I don't think I need to talk to surgeons about that. The other commonality that I found between pilots and surgeons is that they continue to learn, grow, and become better at all aspects of our craft and ourselves. And not only that, the technical skills of surgery constitute only a small part of our performance as a surgeon. It is our inner self, beliefs, self-esteem, mindset, emotional quotient, and the state of mind that have our major impact on our behavior and our performance as a surgeon. And this topic has been well studied. Even anxiety can affect our surgical performance. There are many papers and large volume. There's one such paper which says that surgical cognitive simulation can improve real world surgical performance. And achieving flow in surgery was a cardiothoracic surgeon giving a presidential address where the flow has been described as being in the zone. We all have experienced this flow when we do a fantastic surgery. It's almost everything works well and it's everything is flowing. We are focused, we are relaxed, and surgery seems to go very nicely. But thus, this should be our aim to achieve this flow in 99% of our surgeries. And if we are aware of this and if we start working towards this, then this can become a reality. Our beliefs also influence our decision. Self-belief like I am worthy, I am good, we'll have courage, confidence to assert ourselves and progress in our job as well as private practice. Otherwise, if we don't have this self-belief, we might struggle with confidence, have limited ambition, have no courage for risky decision. We also have belief about other people. If we believe that the world is a hostile environment, then we have trust issues. We struggle with our colleagues, with our staff, with our relationships. And if we believe that world of people is friendly and conquerable, then we have happiness all around, we have friendship, we have trust in people, we have good relationships, and we have good social skills. This says that beliefs affect an individual's perception of reality by creating filters that are applied at the beginning of the decision-making process. So we could have a personal limiting belief. Like, I have to choose between making a living and making a difference. I can't have both. I can't make money and do what I love to do. This could be a limiting belief. In fact, this paper says that there are many factors that affect a surgical decision making, and this was a qualitative study. Surgeon's comfort or championing a procedure can affect decision making. A surgeon starts feeling that if he's comfortable with the procedure, then they generally select that procedure. They don't go with evidence-based. Most surgeons are comfortable with tried and true methods, which have been tried for last decades. All surgeons felt that very comfortable to offer a procedure that they champion to their patients. If I start loving ETEP RS, then I will start championing it and offering it to all my patients, regardless of the size of hernia. This is a common psychological thing that happened to all of us. Surgeons' ego does play a role, and many surgeons admitted that their view of a specific condition and how it should be treated could overrule a body of evidence, because a surgeon believes that I am right and he can overlook evidence which can tell him that he may not be right. So tried and true methods, a procedure that they champion, and surgeon's ego are major factors that affect our surgical decision making. And again, a belief that the risk is low during a procedure can put the patient at risk. We must be able to evaluate risk in its actual reality. Beliefs can be limiting and beliefs can be freeing. Limiting beliefs are not necessarily negative, but they restrict us from a greater good. And sometimes they cannot allow you to do the things that you want to do. You will act and make decisions according to your belief. Therefore, limiting belief will be equal to limiting action, limited decisions, limited results. Open belief will result in an open action, open decisions, open result. Good things about beliefs is they can be changed. Obviously, it's a whole different seminar just to talk about how to overcome limiting beliefs. It's an ongoing process. Identifying the limiting belief is step one. Then becoming aware of it, then you have to replace it with a new and a positive empowering one, and then you have to practice it, affirm it, or actually do it so that it will get ingrained in your psyche. And also, our people who surround us, look for people with positive belief and start acting in a way that you will have a better belief, so that your limiting belief will go away and you can get into a positive mindset. Many other things influence our decision making: situational awareness, mindset. Mindset is a fixed mental attitude or disposition that predetermines a person's response to and interpretation of situations. And we can have a fixed mindset or a growth mindset. In a fixed mindset, that people believe that their basic qualities like intelligence or talent or surgical skill is a fixed trait. They are born with a set of abilities and no more. They cannot be improved. They will have difficulty in changing, learning new skills. They believe that they have a fixed set of abilities and cannot grow beyond them. They will not try new things. They will avoid difficulties and they will get crushed with failures. Whereas people with growth mindset, people believe that their most basic abilities can be developed through dedication, through training, through hard work, and talents and brains is just the starting point. People believe that they are inherently capable of learning, doing new things. Sky is the limit. They are not afraid to try new things. They can fail but learn, and they love challenges. So, last few points of the talk. Again, another commonality that we have is pilots and surgeons both understand the importance of inner self governing the outer self. And the physical fitness. It's not just about the inner self, but even of our physical bodies. Reading, attending programs, self-development in all formats, giving time and importance to our inner self are some of the ways where we can start looking at our inner self and become better persons so that we can even become better surgeons. Pilots and surgeons, we are all team leaders and we need to have a rapport with our team. And this is all known to us. And it is all the more important in abdominal wall reconstruction surgeries, where a team is important. Having a rapport with our team is important. And especially when we are doing a complex surgery and handling a complication, having a team in sync with us is very, very important. Not only that, we need to polish our communication skills. We must learn to use precise and effective and respectful words. All of us get into habit of using same words, same sentences, years and years, year after year. We don't ever look at that. We have gone into habit of using the same kind of sentences, the same words, the same ways of communication, until someone points out that this is not the right way to do it. Why not we ourselves take it as a goal to look at our communications from time to time and see if you have not got into a rut, into a routine of using the same things all over, and learn to use better communication skills. Because better communication skills, the communication is the one that we do with ourselves, and communication is the one that we do with everyone around. So it is not just communication with the patient, but with the relatives, with our friends, with our family, and especially with our staff and our team. So now, all these commonalities that we have seen, we've already seen the great movie where Tom Hanks did the part of Captain Chesley Sullenberger, and he was a pilot who landed his plane. We've actually experienced that tense moment where he made that survival possible. I loved the video where he has actually spoken about his actual experience, Captain Chesley Sullenberger. And that video does bring it to life, all these different aspects, the commonalities between a pilot and surgeon. So before I end my talk, I think let's have a look at this short video where we can hear the actual real Captain Chesley Sullenberger, who was the pilot who landed that plane on the Hudson and saved those 155 people. That was pretty powerful, and I hardly have any words to say after that, because that signifies all that we as persons live our lives. And here, at the end of the talk, let me again reiterate that as pilots and surgeons, we all train hard, we take responsibility, we follow checklists and protocols. Let us prepare ourselves and our teams to handle emergencies. Let us build teams and inspire them. Let us excel in our communication, verbal, non-verbal, written, social, whatever. And continue to get flying hours, training, more skills under our belt, and grow as a person and as a surgeon. So friends, let us be pilots of our lives, of our patients, our operating teams, our hospital staff, our surgical abdominal wall reconstruction surgeons community, and our society. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shinde, sir. That I should say not only was a very motivating and inspiring talk, also a spine-chilling talk at times. You know, when you look at those moments, how agonizing they would have been. But yes, like as you said, you know, they are taking care of 100 some people, but similarly as surgeons, we also take care of one patient at a time. So there is so much that we could really learn from aerospace and pilots. And, you know, thank you for sharing so many pointers that we could, you know, look at and do in our day-to-day life, and take the onus on us, the responsibility on us to train ourselves, build the team, like you said, and be prepared for any eventuality. So we could aim at zero error, or, you know, never having an error like the pilots do, and do it right every patient, every time. So yes, thank you so much. There's so much that we learned from your very inspiring talk. Thank you. So I'm sure we may have questions towards the end for the Q&A, some questions, because I know behind the practical approach, as you have shown, there's a lot of philosophy involved. So it's not just a practical approach. So thank you. And so for, I think we'll go for the next talk from Dr. Aparna Deshpande. I would request her to share her screen.
We are quite speechless after the excellent presentation. So thank you very much.
While ma'am is doing that, I'll just give a brief introduction of Dr. Deshpande. She is, of course, very well known in not just the AWR circles, but, you know, in Maharashtra. She is a professor of surgery at GS8 Medical College and KEM Hospital. She runs a very busy unit there. She is the head of the unit with a very diverse surgical practice, with special interests ranging from HPB to advanced laparoscopy to endoscopic hernia surgery. Apart from being a very busy surgeon, she's also, you know, a very strong academician. She has published over 50 papers. She has simultaneously been very active in a lot of surgical bodies. She has been an EC member of the Maharashtra ASI, the IAGS. She has been a very strong trainer and educator and academician. So, ma'am, I request you to please, give us the practical approach how to handle the difficult, complex AWR. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas, for the lovely introduction. And again, I would like to thank Shinde sir for putting it very nicely across as to what should be the philosophy behind dealing with such complex patients. And I think most of the case scenarios are going to draw from Dr. Shinde sir's talk in some way or the other. So what I am intending to do is present a few cases, some that are complex hernias, some that are loss of domain, and some other problems like septic abdomens, essentially trying to touch upon the principles of abdominal wall reconstruction as a specialty, as it is growing, very rightly said by Dr. Vikas. So essentially, what is the goal of abdominal wall reconstructions? Most of these patients would be treated in an elective setting. There are a few patients in whom emergency intervention is required when they land up in incarceration or obstruction. And in this set of patients, ideally, there is very little that you can offer in terms of reconstruction, because your whole idea at that point is to take a trip to the operating room and relieve the patient of the obstruction and then deal with the reconstruction part later on. But as I said, most of the patients would have chronic irritating problems. They essentially have large swellings. They may have very wide necked hernias, so obstruction need not necessarily be a problem. So what we are dealing with in these kind of patients is the quality of life. And therefore, there should be no compromise in optimizing these patients prior to putting them under the knife. Because these are patients who are not coming to you for any life-threatening condition, but they are coming for a better life or a better quality of life. And what are the means to achieve these goals of AWR? And essentially, you need to restore the integrity of the musculofacial and overlying soft tissue layers. You have to prevent visceral eventuation and provide a dynamic, that is a functional muscular support. And all this while, one has to strive to reduce the local complications and recurrence. So going to the first scenario. So this is a case who is a 28-year-old with a history of three previous lower segment cesarean sections. And the last LSCS is 2 years back. She does not have any comorbidities. She has a BMI of around 28. Now, you can see that there is a bulge in the lower abdomen and a vertical midline scar of the previous LSCS. Whenever such a patient comes to you, one has to review for risk factors for failure of primary repair, because this is the first time you are offering a repair of the dehiscence, so to say, in this kind of a patient. And you wouldn't want your primary repair to fail, because these are ripe situations which will lead to complex or hernias or scenarios where you will then require, you know, major surgical interventions. So you need to assess for all risk factors for failure of primary repair. Fortunately for us in this patient, she is not obese. There is no previous skin surgical site infection. The hernia size is relatively not very, the neck of the defect is not very large, but when you see on the lateral aspect, there is a bulge And on leg raising, there is a significant weakness in the anterior abdominal wall. The neck of the defect, though, is not particularly big. It is about 4 centimeters or so. And there is no significant loss of domain or such. Luckily, there is no tobacco exposure in this patient. There is no history of delayed healing. So essentially, all the factors that might lead to failure of primary repair are in there. And as far as the risk stratification for local wound related problems, she is in a low risk or a grade 1 category. So once you have ascertained more or less these problems, you then need to do a preoperative evaluation of these patients. And the major investigation that we now rely upon is the contrast enhanced CT scan with an oral and an intravenous contrast. A good CT scan gives you the depth of the hernia, the presence of the rectus abdominis on both sides, and the quality of the rectus abdominis, the horizontal distance at the neck, as well as the size of the hernia sac, and sometimes you can also assess the perforator anatomy. Now, in addition to the imaging, you also need to see the nutritional status of the patient. So we assess the serum albumin level, look for any other illnesses, you look for HbA1c in diabetic patients. And if there is any tobacco exposure, I think that is something that really needs to be looked into and needs to be stopped. Because tobacco is something that causes poor tissue perfusion, poor oxygenation, and leads to a lot of wound-related problems. It also has an effect on the respiratory function or the ciliary movement. And a 6 to 8 week cessation of tobacco is something that has been recommended prior to putting the patient up for the surgery. So essentially, I think again, here Dr. Shinde was talking about, that we need to give that kind of time for the preoperative workup for the patient. If the patient is exposed to tobacco, you need to make the patient understand the risks and problems of it, and ask him to stop smoking or stop chewing tobacco for a period of 8 weeks before taking up the person for surgery. Once you have evaluated that the patient is otherwise fit, no other comorbidities, no previous SSIs, you now want to plan the proper surgical procedure for this patient. And as we have already discussed, that the aim of the surgery will be to have a tension-free myofascial continuity, and as now more or less accepted world over, there should be a reinforcement with a mesh. And the ideal location to place the mesh is within the well vascularized layers of the abdominal wall. Now, if we look carefully at this, then what is the best place for placing the mesh? Then it becomes the retrorectus place above the posterior rectus sheath, because there the mesh is really lying between a nice muscular rectus abdominis anteriorly and a vascularized posterior rectus sheath and a transversalis fascia and peritoneum inferiorly. So the ideal place always to place the mesh would be a retrorectus plane. However, a large sublay, that is a large intraperitoneal repair, is also acceptable. That means a good IPOM with a very wide overlap of the mesh is equally acceptable, with proper fixation of the mesh. And of course, at the same time, an onlay repair which lies on the anterior rectus sheath between the subcutaneous tissues and the anterior rectus sheath is also one of the very commonly performed repairs, and something that one cannot completely discard. So the surgical options, as I said, for this patient would be an open retrorectus re-stopa, maybe with a limited tar if needed, because this defect is coming up just to the umbilicus, and if you need, you may have to add a limited tar bilaterally or unilaterally in this patient. For people who are very specialized in laparoscopic surgery, may attempt an ETAP re-stopa in this patient. All laparoscopic transabdominal approaches, so a transperitoneal or a TARM or a tape, that is transabdominal partially extraperitoneal repairs, could only be the peritoneal findings. And as I said, an online repair is always feasible. Sometimes a hybrid repair can also be offered depending upon the intraperitoneal findings. Of course, if you are doing an onlay repair, we know that one has to be very, very careful. So the undermining of the subcutaneous may cause loss of blood supply to the skin flaps, leading to problems of wound healing and then problems of exposure of the mesh. So knowing anatomy of the perforators and knowing the vascular anatomy of the abdominal wall is quite vital while performing all these surgeries. But gentle handling of the tissues, proper retraction, using moist mops, oxygenating while trying to establish the subcutaneous spleen, and thereafter a proper occlusion of the subcutaneous space, occlusion of all dead space, and properly placed drains will generally help in avoiding any kind of cutaneous problems. All extra skin which is looking doubtful viability should be trimmed, and properly nourished, properly skin that has good blood supply should be retained. You should reduce the undermining as much as possible. Now for this there are multiple options that have been described, which we will come later when we are talking of complement separation. It is essential to declog the drains in the post-operative period routinely, and appropriate pressure dressings and binders for a few months should be advocated. I'll come to a similar patient, a second case, who's a 27-year-old female patient, operated for an emergency appendectomy 6 years back by a right paramedian incision. Now she was reoperated 1 month later, but she does not have any details, and she complains of a gap in her belly with pain. Now this is the picture of the abdominal wall. Now you can see that there is a very badly secondarily healed wound of the previous appendectomy, and on leg raising there is a significant bulging outside of the abdominal wall. Now she is a known case of pulmonary tuberculosis, which she claims to have completed treatment. She is quite undernourished actually, barely her BMI is 20 because she is tall. She has completed her family, so which is also one of the important things. So history of the patient with all relevant social data, the background, the domestic responsibilities, I think all these need to be completely covered when you are working up the patient. She does not have diabetes, but she is poorly nourished and she has mild tachypnea. She is again a case of a wound dehiscence which has occurred, and you have about a 6.7 centimeter defect which is in the right paramedian space, which is a little higher up than the previous defect that we discussed, and the vertical extent of the defect is about 9 centimeters. Unfortunately, though this patient does not have much risk factor apart from nutrition, she has a very poor pulmonary picture on the CT scan. So there is old healed tuberculosis, there is fibrocavitary changes in the lungs, and both the lung fields are pretty affected. So she is a patient who is going to need a lot of respiratory function optimization. She is going to go to the chest medicine specialty for a long time. She also side by side needs nutritional optimization. We need to confirm that there is a control of tuberculosis, and then and only then can we offer her surgical treatment. Now what surgical treatment can be offered? Again, as I said, now this particular patient, the scar being very bad, in such set of patients it does not make much sense to offer them laparoscopic approach, because you need to remove all the affected scar tissue, and these are the patients where when the muscles are very nice and vascularized, you may do well with a retrorectus repair. Few other examples of similar cases. So this is a patient with a previous onlay mesh, and you can see that the mesh has not been accepted well by the tissues. It must have been an onlay. It has become collected at one point, and another patient with a bad secondary healing. Now, in these cases, the patients are more concerned about the scar and the swelling rather than only the hernia. So for them, the cosmetic benefit of the surgery is also equally important. And in these patients, removal of these scars. So as you see here, the hernia sac is not too much. In fact, there is hardly any hernia in outpouching, but there, and the defect is about 6 centimeters in the midline, and the bowel is firmly adherent to the scar from inside. So these are the patients in whom you need to excise the scar completely. And while doing that, you will probably be able to offer a very good retrorectus mesh placement for these patients. So here, as you can see, a complete excision of the scar is required. You have to be very careful because the bowel is firmly adherent below, and you need to prevent any kind of enterotomy, which will change your management completely in these patients. So being careful about the dissection, avoiding enterotomy gives you multiple options of mesh placement. And in this set of patients, you can incise the posterior rectus sheath about 0.5 centimeters from its medial end, enter the retrorectus space on both the sides, completely open the retrorectus space up to the linea semilunaris on both sides, and achieve a good posterior rectus sheath suturing in the midline, and thereafter place the mesh. Most of the times, these patients do very well with the retrorectus mesh placement. You can, when you're suturing the anterior sheath, sometimes you may need to use the sac to supplement the anterior suturing. And in such cases, you may have to also use a polypropylene mesh because you do not want the mesh to be exposed to the skin. So a retrorectus placement is very good for these kind of patients. And most of these patients do very well. You are not undermining the subcutaneous tissue, and therefore the chances of wound related problems and exposure become very, very less. Again, the same problem or the same care about the postoperative treatment of the drains, declogging of the drains, mobilization of the patient, care of the abdominal wall, care of the wound will continue as for all patients. Let us now come to the next two patients where we will talk a little bit about loss of dolie. This is a 75-year-old female who has been carrying a bulge around her lower abdomen and right flank since many years. She has no symptoms as such except for the large bulge, and she is very well compensating for the drag. She is a known hypertensive, she is a diabetic and an asthmatic. We know that whenever there are large hernias and a lot of the bowel is lying outside of the true peritoneal cavity, the intraperitoneal pressure reduces, the diaphragm descends, there is portal venous stasis, the bowel can become edematous, and all this along with the drag on the blood supply on the mesentery can cause a lot of backache and other postural problems for the patient. So this was the appearance of the patient with a large swelling around the right lower abdomen. And she was not obese again. She had a low BMI, but she was a diabetic and she was an asthmatic, hypertensive. And at 75, whatever routine household movement that was required out of her, she was able to carry out comfortably. Her CT scan showed a very large peritoneal sac outside, or the hernial sac was really large. And comparatively, the neck of the hernia was only 3.9 centimeters by 3.8 centimeters. So for a surgeon, this was a person who was definitely standing on the verge of getting obstructed anytime. And obviously, I wanted to offer her surgery right away. There was no other option in my mind for the patient. As you can see here, so she had this effect, which was bowel loops were coming out. And comparatively, the amount of bowel outside was significant. It measured to about 15 to 18% of her total peritoneal volume. Looking at the muscles of the abdominal wall, you know, they were pretty thinned out, and there was hardly any muscular mass on the abdominal wall. So does she qualify for a case to be labeled as loss of domain. According to this publication, which was published in 2019, an international Delphi consensus of expert surgeons was conducted. And surprisingly, after three sets of questionnaires and three rounds of voting, there really was no consensus about the percentage volume that required to label a person as loss of domain. So it ranged from 15% in some surgeons to 50% in some surgeons. So there was no common ground as to qualify a patient to or define a patient as loss of domain. However, everybody agreed that a ventral hernia large enough such that simple reduction in its contents and primary abdominal closure either cannot be achieved without additional reconstructive techniques, or if achieved, or cannot be achieved without a significant risk of complications due to raised intra-abdominal pressure. In her case, again, if you see in the upper abdomen also, the muscles are extremely thin and atrophic. She hardly has any muscle. Even her obliques are very thin, the recti are flat and very, very thin. So this is a patient who, when the bowel would go back inside the abdomen, I don't know how she is going to respond. Probably there would be not much rise in the intra-abdominal pressure, because as it is, the abdominal musculature is extremely weak. So can we call her borderline LOD? I don't know. I tried to look up the term called borderline LOD, and the only thing I came up with was borderline personality disorder. But anyway, I decided to call this patient as borderline LOD. And what are the different options? She was actually, if you just look at the abdomen, she was quite a dream, because she had only one TL scar. Her LACS scar was well healed. So she could have been very nicely probably managed with either a TAPP or a TARM, depending upon the intra-abdominal findings. Of course, an open reef stopper with TAR, if necessary, was always an option. And of course, looking at the condition of the muscles, and if we are only going to give her a very basic support for the abdominal wall with a narrow defect of 3 to 4 centimeters, an open onlay is always in as one of your backups that you can offer. And again, in expert hands, maybe an ETEP RS could have also been offered for this patient. But this was from the point of view of a surgeon. Of course, she would have needed a lot of optimization. She would have required respiratory management postoperatively. If we subjected her to laparoscopic surgery, she may require ICU care depending upon the duration of the surgery. And all this was explained and discussed to her. However, the patient was very comfortable with that bulge. Her only worry was she wanted to travel abroad to her son after the first lockdown. And her question was whether during her travel, whether she will have any kind of a problem. So as a surgeon, all I could tell her that you are at a very high risk of obstruction, but it has been there for the last 20 years. So it's the decision up to you. If during travel, by any misfortune, you go into obstruction, you have to go and get yourself operated immediately. So this patient was very clear that she did not want to be operated, and the patient is even now, about 13 months since I've seen her, is comfortably carrying this bulge. In fact, these pictures are just sent by her to me 4 days back. Now, the next patient that I'm going to describe is really a dream, I would say, for all AWR patients. Again, a 73-year-old female patient presented with a large swelling, no episodes of intestinal obstruction. She had 3 prior hernia repairs following 1 umbilical hernia surgery. So 4 surgeries in all, and the second surgery was a laparoscopic, it was an IPOM, and all others were open. What was surprising is that almost every surgery was followed by a recurrence within about 3 to 4 months of the surgery. 38 obstructed sleep apnea, she was a borderline diabetic, and she was very poorly mobile because of her condition of the abdominal wall. So she had this abdomen which was like a battle scarred abdomen completely, Few of our members here must have seen this patient when I discussed it in May 2021. And she had this large hernia with multiple outpouchings or loculations, if you would call them so. And this was her CT scan where again, she had something like a second abdomen. So there was a study by Binsar et al. And they found that even the definition of LOD was unclear, or rather every paper would describe LOD in different terms. And second abdomen was one of the terms that has been used to indicate loss of domain. So this was her CT scan, and she was a patient with so many repairs before, with onlay and IPOM. And of course, once I saw her, I am already looking at her obliques and trying to think whether she is a good candidate for a TAR procedure, or a transversus abdominis release, which is the current most established procedure for major reconstructions of the abdominal wall. So she had a 10 centimeter defect horizontally, and all the bowel almost was outside. And on CT scan, she had this one vertical defect, which was 12 centimeters. And she had another defect in the epigastric area, which was about 2.5 centimeters. So because her clinical examination of the abdomen was so limited because of the multiple defects and bulges, the CT scan revealed this additional. And this is how CT helps us in making sure that when we operate, we try to cover all the defects in such patients. So in her case, again, there was actually no question of a non-operative management. There was a possibility of obstruction. The patient had a poor quality of life. And I met her first in April, and I could see that over a period of 1 to 2 months, already her muscles were retracting significantly. There was a drag on her back, and her respiratory functioning was deteriorating. So she definitely was, for me, a good candidate for TAR, for a good retromuscular repair, a risk of exposure of mesh being low, and as we already discussed, in an ideal plane, which will keep the mesh in place by the Laplace's law, and it covers the entire greater sac. However, in TAR, if the closure of posterior rectus sheath is under tension, then it may give way to expose the mesh to the bowel, which may be a bigger problem than having the mesh exposed to the atmosphere. Postoperative raised IH, intra-abdominal hypertension, or ileus, which is also likely to happen in many of these patients, will test your closure. And it really needs meticulous and anatomical dissection in order to prevent any neurovascular damage to the anterior abdominal wall. One systematic review in 2019 shows that the recurrence rate with TAR is quite low. They have studied about 646 patients, and the mean hernia surface was 509 centimeters square. And in this group, they found a 4% recurrence of TAR patients. So in my mind, I was already thinking that this patient is going to come up for TAR, and we started her counseling. Of course, that was kind of one of the options. We always had to talk about various options, counsel about various options. One has to go into the detail of history to try and find out what was the cause of the earlier failure or the recurrence. Because when such a patient comes to a surgeon, the surgeon is very worried to even offer any kind of surgical intervention. Because within 3 to 4 months, if it is going to recur, after going through so much of workup and back-breaking work, you don't want the patient to land up in the same condition that she or he is in. So one needs to really understand what is the likely problem. So in her case, of course, we know that she was obese, that she had a respiratory dysfunction. These were reasons enough for the failure. But also, I found out from the patient that she was used to sitting on the floor for a lot of religious reasons, and sitting down and getting up was a very routine for her. So we had to kind of counsel her that this is something that you will not be able to do. So every small activity needs to be really scrutinized well. She was counseled for various possible options, the need for post-op ICU care. And one dietary consultation was set up so that she gets into the idea that she has to lose weight. because definitely obese patients have a higher rate of recurrence. If the BMI crosses 40, then the rate of recurrence is close to 45% at 2 years of repair. And she definitely was a candidate for that. And whether to offer bariatric surgery to this patient, that is a whole different debate. For a 73-year-old who has come to me for a quality of life problem and for back issues, it is difficult to put forth bariatric as an option. But patient needs to understand that dietary modifications, understand the caloric intake and try and reduce, start on the path of reduction of weight is what is important. So we set that up, chest medicine evaluation. So she required multidisciplinary management with the cardiologist, physician, anesthetist, chest physician, dietitian, physiotherapist. The second thing in these patients, incentive spirometry can be started preoperatively, because most of these patients in the post-op stage are not going to be in a condition to understand how the spirometer works. So it is very good to start them preoperatively for optimization of the chest on incentive spirometry. When we calculated the CT scan for loss of domain by volumetric assessment, it was nearly 37% of the total abdominal volume was outside of the peritoneal cavity. So she definitely was a candidate of loss of domain. And again, there was another round of counseling where we discussed the implications of this. We discussed the possibility of having to set up preoperative progressive pneumoperitoneum or botulinum injections. The entire details of the procedure has to be explained to the patient. They have to be explained what is loss of domain, what it means, and post-operatively what it means to the patient. Requirement of ventilatory support, prolonged ICU care, and what are the economics of all these things. So every detail has to be discussed with the patient, so that they are on the same page with you and they are willing to go with you along the proper path. So this patient chose to go for a pneumoperitoneum rather than botulinum injections. And from the left flank, one port was established and we could see the hernia, see the bowel going through the hernia. And it was reducible, but as I said, I just wanted to establish the pneumoperitoneum and wait at this point of time. And we put about 1 liter of gas inside our abdominal cavity. At the end of which, however, the abdomen was looking very scary, frankly, to me. I was not liking the look of the abdomen, but we were going as per the theoretical suggestions. And as I said, we were already planning for a transversus abdominis release, which essentially is an extension of the retrorectus repair. So here you can see that this is the after you complete the retrorectus dissection, identify the linea semilunaris and about 0.5 centimeters medial to the linea semilunaris, preserving the neurovascular bundles going to the obliques. You incise the posterior rectus sheath in a way that you preserve the inner layer of the transversalis fascia and the peritoneum. And once that incision is made, you sweep up the transversalis muscle along with the obliques up away from the peritoneum and the transversalis fascia. So you can get into this large avascular retromuscular plane, which starts from one psoas and ends on the other psoas. And superiorly, you can go right up to the central tendon of the diaphragm and inferiorly up to the bladder neck. So you can get a wide greater visceral sac and for placing the mesh. And this is the closure of the posterior rectus sheath. And if you have done a proper dissection, you can see that there is hardly any tension on this suture line, because this is the key. If your PRS closure is under tension, then you are going to have problems in the post-operative. So this is the closed PRS here. And then the mesh can be placed along the entire greater visceral sac. We also keep the peritoneal sac so that in case there is any problem for closure of the anterior rectus sheath, you can use the extra peritoneal sac as a bridge in order to avoid tension on the anterior suture line. However, all the plans had to be changed because this patient went into a postoperative intestinal obstruction. Within 48 hours of the pneumoperitoneum establishment, what had happened is all her bowel was pushed into the sac. The intestines had air and fluid levels. She was manifesting clinical obstruction. And we could see that even the stomach, which was earlier inside the abdomen, was now into that upper defect. And the pneumoperitoneum, which was attempted, I was trying to see, it was hardly existent in the abdominal cavity. So this was a failed pneumoperitoneum, and in fact, this patient from an elective procedure had kind of become a semi-emergent procedure, and we had to take her to OT and then deal with all the adhesions, open up the neck, and then this was not definitely a case to go for a transversus abdominis release, because already with the bowels so distended, if you try and do a TAR and then close the PRS under tension, and these patients likely will go into more ileus postoperatively and cause more problems by the splitting of the PRS closure. So we had to offer her anterior component separation. This picture is not of the same patient, but because I didn't have her pictures, I have taken the anterior component separation picture. Essentially, it is incision of the anterior anterior oblique, and you can extend it right from the costal margin down to the inguinal area, and then separate the obliques, the external from the internal oblique, and create enough movement of the sheath so that the midline closure can be achieved. Now, the problem with this anterior component, a lot of people claim that it again it disturbs the cutaneous blood supply and causes ischemia and wound related problems. So there are other descriptions of perforator sparing procedures in order to avoid such problems, which are which are practiced by a few surgeons. Again, we had to place a polypropylene mesh on the anterior sheath, and the mesh has to be placed in such a way that it is lying flat. There are not too many creases on that, so that prevents seroma formation. And the choice of mesh is very important. If you are using intraperitoneally, or if there is any possibility that the mesh will be exposed to the bowel, then a composite mesh is absolute requirement. You should not use a polypropylene mesh. If you are placing a mesh in the retrorectus space and the peritoneum is nicely closed and there are no openings in the peritoneum, so also for a TAR, then you can use a polypropylene mesh. Debate between midweight and heavyweight is, I think, a lot beyond the scope of this, because there's so much to discuss in AWR. So I'm just kind of restricting myself to these midline hernias. I'm not even going to lumbar or subxiphoid and suprapubic. But placement of the mesh universally has to be flat, has to be nice, and the fixation also has to be proper so that there is no movement of the mesh. So in this patient's case, we did an adhesiolysis, defect delineation, we did a midline closure ACST with a 30 by 30 centimeters mesh. She also got a nice abdominoplasty for free, and there were drains put and post-operative course. So this is the last principle of a proper AWR, and that is thorough post-operative management of the patient. And a prolonged ICU care was required for her. She needed to be ventilated for 2 days, but thereafter she was weaned off. She needed CPAP for a long time because of her OSA. Thorough sugar control, glycemic level should never go above 160 in these patients. You need to anticoagulate them. You need a complete monitoring of the hemodynamics of the central venous pressure, because you don't want to overload them. You don't want bowel to become more edematous than what it is. So monitoring of the electrolytes, keeping the potassium levels within range so that ileus doesn't set in, daily counts to see that there is no infection, and physiotherapy for the limbs, for the chest, and early mobilization as soon as possible. So post-operative management and pre-operative management is actually the key to a very small intraoperative part or your technical skills. If you do not, you know, give enough importance to the pre and the post-op care, then a lot of your patients are likely to have a problem. So this patient stayed in the hospital for nearly 21 days. She was discharged. She needed nighttime CPAP for a couple of months thereafter. She had to follow a diet chart. So preoperatively, she had lost about 3 kilograms, which was really nothing. But at least she had an idea that she had to remain on a thorough diet and she had to be properly, monitoring her diet all the time. Physiotherapy was advised at home and abdominal binders. So now at discharge, she had a minimal edge necrosis on the vertical limb. Now after the entire procedure and the entire hospital stay, a dry superficial necrosis I was willing to accept, but I made sure that there was no infection in that and that it was a superficial necrosis. No negative wound negative pressure wound management was done here, and dry dressings and trying to keep the sugar levels under control was all that was done. And over a period of time, the superficial necrosis separated out, and on nearly 2.5 months post-op, we could give her this tiny secondary suturing. And this is the patient now at nearly 28 months post-operatively. As of now, she is comfortable. She is not having any complaints or which are suggestive of a recurrence. We have patients which are sometimes really, really bad. So this is a patient with, and apart from her first surgery, all the surgeries I have been instrumental in performing. So I am kind of, you know, responsible for her condition. Now she had an emergency. First time when she came to me, it was for an emergency obstructed incisional hernia, where in the middle of the night we had to operate, but there was no enterotomy and an only mesh was put. She was found to have a rectosigmoid stricture, which was the cause of her constipation and her problems, which was found about 2 years on. And that time an emergency transverse colostomy, right transverse colostomy was required. Thereafter a planned AR was done, open midline incision, then a planned closure of colostomy. And over a period of time, she has this gradual weakening of the entire left lower abdomen. And you can actually see her previous mesh is exposed in this area. And the entire left iliac fossa is kind of absent. And there is a sagging of the entire abdominal wall. Now, according to the ventral hernia working group grading, she is having a grade 4 hernia. So she is in an infected synthetic mesh. And she also had an presence of a stoma earlier. Of course, that is closed now. But she is a patient who is very high risk for any kind of procedure for local problems and for recurrence. Now, what do you do for such patients? Do you attempt to restore the structure and function by a retrorectus mesh placement if possible? In these patients, biological meshes have been advocated because biological meshes tend to overcome infection or tend to survive within infection much better than synthetic meshes, though they are less durable or less strong as compared to the synthetic meshes. And the other techniques that in such patients which may be recommended are plastic and reconstructive techniques with free or pedicle flaps, which have been widely described in plastic surgical literature. And sometimes in extreme conditions, a composite abdominal wall transplantation has also been described, which is, for me also, this was new learning thanks to this lecture. About 21 cases have happened since 1994, where the entire abdominal wall has been transplanted for various, primarily 5 of these patients were also other organ recipients. Sometimes you have this terrible, terrible septic conditions, where all you want is that for somehow or the other for the abdominal wall to come back. So this was a patient of a spontaneous colidocal rupture in her 9th month of pregnancy, and she lost the child, and we had to do an emergency exploration. She needed 3 emergency explorations after that because forever there was a bile leak in spite of the PTBDs and all. Then after about a year of controlling all that, she came for a bilioenteric repair, and we did her bilioenteric repair. Unfortunately, during that, there was a small colonic tear during that surgery, and the result of that on the 4th post-op day was this entire suture line being open and so much of slough on the bowel that one really didn't know what to do. And for such patients, you can really thank the newer technology where you have negative pressure wound tactics. And after just 48 hours of application of one NPWT for her, we had some turning around of sorts and there was some hope. And then over a period of time, this patient actually did exceedingly well. In fact, this patient has not developed a hernia. So her muscles have completely come back. She had this jejunal perforation also, which happened. She had a small colonic rupture, but everything was managed without much intersurgical intervention thereafter. This PTBD was her lifeline and all through. And as of now, she is completely, her wound has healed. All she has is that tiny colonic fistula, which she says that, you know, I don't want anything to be done for that. I'm okay with that. She just places a gauze piece on the abdomen and changes it once in the day. That is all. So essentially for elective AWR, we want to achieve a strong, durable, dynamic abdominal wall, which is best obtained by a mesh reinforced and innervated musculofacial reapproximation. We want to prevent complications. And these were the principles that I tried to touch upon during all these case presentations. So select the correct patient and optimize. Most important is optimization of their modifiable risk factors. Select the correct procedure for the patient, not select the correct procedure for the surgeon. So I think one has to align oneself to the patient's circumstance. So the age of the patient, the expectation of the patient, the social conditions, the time and responsibility, everything. The third special attention is the issue, because you don't want bad wounds as far as is possible, and carefully manage the patient post-operatively. So again, in a nutshell, align with the goals of the patient, do in-depth inquiry about the patient's conditions, thorough pre-operative counseling, careful workup, meticulous technique, adhering to principles. And in one of the references that I read, I was very sad to read this, that most of the patients who come to you, they have had mediocre operations before, and there is only one chance for them to have a gold standard operation. So I would suggest that all of us, just as Shinde sir said, that whatever we do, finally every surgery that we do, one has to treat like the last surgery for this patient. The patient should not need any surgery after this. So whether you are doing an IPOM, whether you're doing an ETEP, whatever you're doing, follow the principles, follow the proper selection of patient, selection of technique, selection of mesh, and a thorough, meticulous following of technique is mandatory, so that we don't create complex hernias. All the simple hernias should be treated and dealt with. And most importantly, the patient has to know the importance of weight control, dietary and lifestyle changes, and the straining factors. So I think this should be treated, or hernia should be treated, like bariatric surgery. You know, once you have a bariatric patient, the patient is with you for life. So your hernia patient should all the time be in follow-up. They should know the importance of remaining on track and avoiding a recurrence, because all hernias recur. Today morning, I asked from Dr. Ramana about the abstract for the paper he had recently shared on the group. And even in TAR, with a large size TAR, 27% recurrence has been found in a certain group of patients. So basically, try to avoid making a complex hernia. This is a graph or a flow chart that I have picked up from one of the references. This is the study, which is a practical guideline for implementation of shared decision making, which is extremely important. So multidisciplinary management and shared decision making, I think, is the crux of managing any ventral hernias, whether simple or complex. These are the references that I have referred to, and this one especially with Eric Pollai has given excellent video document demonstrations of both ACST and PCST, I would recommend all of you to go, and it's available free on the net and to see that. So thank you everybody for listening to me patiently, and I have probably exceeded time a little bit as usual. But my, you know, deepest gratitude to my institution and all my teachers there, the AWRSC committee, patients, colleagues, and all the postgraduates who work with me for so long. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Very interesting talk. You know, I'm sure most of us don't envy your practice, which seems to be so many complex AWR cases and so well managed, you know, in spite of their complexity. So thank you for that. And, you know, you have very nicely shown that how it's not just about looking at the hernia, but we have to look at the patient as a whole, look at the reasons of failure of previous procedures, look at their comorbidities. So much goes into the planning for doing the right procedure and, you know, choosing the right procedure, choosing the right prosthesis, so, you know, we can optimize the outcome for our patient. So thank you for a fantastic talk. I'm sure we'll have some questions. You know, I think there are a few questions in the chat box. So can I ask, I think Dr. Jignesh Gandhi, he wanted to make a comment. Can I request him to please unmute and make a comment?
Thank you, Vikas. And really thoroughly enjoyed both the talks. Shinde sir, your talk was really fantastic. And it is just a comment because I also like to give examples. So there's an US aviation data. Airline industry is the only industry where they aim for 100% success rate. If airline industry were to think about 99.9% success rate, it would amount to one jet crash every week. So that's the reason, you know, when we go for, you know, any of our flights, we see, you know, they talk about do dwar wahan se, do dwar wahan se. There's a checklist. They keep on doing that. So that's the importance of the US aviation data. And the chance, the industry is so good, is that your plane crash can happen. Chances 1 in 5 million. That your plane would crash. That's only because they have got such a rigorous checklist. They keep on doing that every cycle, every time, again and again. So just to add to the information about the pilot and surgeon, so I just thought I'll give this example for the airline industry. And Dr. Aparna, also fantastic collection of cases and good take-home messages. Thank you very much, Vikas. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you. Lignesh, that was a very interesting and a very valid comment. And thanks for bringing it up. And I really loved your way you are looking at it, because, and I liked your philosophy, if the airline industry can go for 100% accident free.
They have to aim for it. So they have to aim for it. In fact, there are a lot of
AWR also, that should be our aim.
Absolutely. We should always aim for 100% success like an airline industry. And you brought out a very valid point. In fact, there are some markers also, you know, that if you want to really avoid a fatal air crash, you should choose a middle seat in the back. You should have a luggage in front of you. There are six, seven markers. Maybe when we talk on a personal basis, I'll tell you, because I like to compare this airline industry with our surgical work. And I'll definitely share it on some forum. So brilliant talk. Enjoyed it thoroughly. Thank you.
Thank you. I would just like to say that Dr. Ashwin Masurkar seems to be here.
And, and Dr. Abhay Dalvi is also there with us. So,
and he's a trained pilot. So maybe we could have some comments from him.
Absolutely. Good evening, Dalvi, sir. Good
evening, Ashwin Masurkar is there.
Hi, good evening. Wonderful talks. And I concur with what Dr. Jignesh Gandhi said and the importance of checklists. And you brought it up so nicely that you have to check out whether you really your hospital can handle such a case, and whether you have the skill set, whether you have taken adequate opinions and taken inputs. And in that point of view, the various groups that are there in social media, from AWR, from all the associations, where you can take senior opinions before you go ahead with any case. These are very invaluable. And the way we are going, we don't need to leave our homes, and we're having these wonderful talks. It's just wonderful. And apart from bringing the aviation thing into model, the other thing they talk about is the Swiss cheese effect, where whenever there's a disaster in aviation, they do have 100% model success rate. But when they see disaster, they have made an analogy of the Swiss cheese model, where multiple failures happen, and when they come in line, it has an aviation disaster. Similarly, in surgery, when we know one thing is going wrong, it's prudent to take a step back, take a second opinion before you cause a series of disasters and then get into a very big mess. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well said, Captain Ashwin. Well said.
I will just like to add two comments. Is that sir here? I would like him to say something if he's here, because it's really nice of him to join in spite of his busy schedule. I don't know, maybe he has left. So, sir, this its culture of safety in aviation is also followed very rigorously for cholecystectomy. So, it's called as COSIC, culture of safety in cholecystectomy. And that is something that we all follow. And just a curious kind of twist in this, that in the movie Sully, if all of you have seen it, Sully has to face an inquiry. The simulators say that he could have landed on the LaGuardia airport, and it was because of his adventurousness that he risked the lives of 155 people by landing it on the Hudson. And after all the checklists and after all the simulations, it was the human factor of response time that actually made the difference between landing on the water and landing on the airport. So we must have the checklist, definitely, but we are also tending to humans, and I think that together combined will make a great outcome for everybody. Yeah.
One more thing to add.
That was a great point, Aparna. I wanted to put that as a last point, that in spite of being a hero, you also have to face flag by going to courts and facing CPAs. Because of time, I could not. And I think Ashwin wanted to say something.
Yeah. No, about the same thing with the Sully incident, where human factor is brought in, and when they compared the simulation time, that person practiced on the simulator repeatedly. But Sully didn't have the opportunity to ever practice the scenario. This was a dual engine loss, at a very low height, and they had never practiced the scenario. So talking about simulation, the cadaverous program, which you and Dr. Jignesh have started off in KEM and is happening over the country, that is the best way, that the way forward, where simulation for surgeons, we are greatly lacking in simulation models to, mimic scenarios like what you've described. And we really need that kind of a thing so that we are well prepared to handle such eventualities.
And
I did have a question for Dr. Shinde, sir. Hello. So, yes. Dr. Shinde says, I did have a question for you. So, like they say that if I just keep doing one, you keep doing one procedure, you keep getting better and better at it. So even if it's just only, if I keep doing it, I may be able to minimize my complications, keep getting better at it. So here in AWR, we talk about doing a range of procedures. So how do you justify that? Do you, like you said, with pilots, repetition is the key. So should you mix your practice? Should you intentionally do some sublay, some onlay, so that in case of, sometime you're not able to do a sublay, you have that option open. So you don't just have to do it when you can't do anything else. So how do you mix your practice?
Although your concept is absolutely valid and it is being followed in many specialties, many surgeons, and especially in countries where there is a specialty practice and referred practice, and you have specialty referred institutes, the surgeon will not touch any other case but the case that he's doing. If he's doing colorectal, he will not touch anything else. If he's doing certain procedures, he will ask another colleague to take over and do that part. So that concept is very valid. But in abdominal wall reconstruction surgery, the scenario is more complex. It is a little difficult to isolate two procedures for a same problem. A complex abdominal wall defect is one problem, and there are various procedures for it. So we can't have one complex abdominal problem being treated with posterior compartment separation by one group of specialized surgeons, and the same problem being treated by anterior component separation by a specialized group of same surgeons, because some patients might require a choice on the spot. And we do not have the luxury of having patients go to an institute where two separate specialties exist. That if that patient needs anterior component separation, the anterior component group comes and takes over. So we do not have that kind of a separation facility. And therefore, and plus this particular problem being a complex problem of a multiple territorial problem of the abdominal wall. Today we are looking at abdominal core health as a concept, as a philosophy. So therefore, mixed practice, we should be familiar with all the different procedures, and we should be in practice so that we should be able to offer or change our decision to another procedure depending upon the requirements of the patient.
I absolutely agree with you about the core muscle management. I think that is, I forgot to touch upon that, but I think that is a very essential part of most of our pre as well as post-op. So non-weight-bearing core muscle workup or physiotherapy is a vital part, even for reducing interventions for divarication. So that is something that we really need to work on, because the quick fixes are not something that last for long. So that is definitely, and also if you, Dr. Vikas, if you read a lot of papers, you see this description that do a posterior release, then if the closure is not coming, then do an anterior release, then if still closure is not coming, then leave open. This is exactly the situation where nobody should land up in such a situation. That abhi nahi ho raha hai, fir wo nahi ho raha hai, fir abhi laparoscopy rakh do. So I'm sure it would be an extremely rare situation, but I wouldn't wish that on any surgeon. So it's something that we need to be very vigilant about.
Thank you. So I think we are running out of time. I think if Dr. Punjani is there for some closing comments, I think he's still.
Who is there?
Dr. Sharad, please.
Doctor is not there.
Sharad is there, na?
Well, Rahul, come on.
Yeah, Sharad, you can make a final comment.
No, I mean, both our speakers are stalwarts their own way, and they are experienced teachers. And I think none of us here who are present on the scene can really make a comment on these two excellent talks. But yes, I think a holistic approach towards a surgeon's expertise is what is important. And basically what holistic means is it is looking for perfection. So I think that is what Dr. Pramod Shinde really meant, that trying to be perfect through an overall approach. I think that is a really enlightening talk that Dr. Shinde gave. And yes, Dr. Aparna Deshpande has actually dug into a deep well, which is deeper than one can fathom. So it is an excellent talk that she has given. But then, yes, I think a lot of questions will remain unanswered when it comes to LOD and when it comes to the approach towards complex hernias. I think everyone is learning. Even the people who are teaching are discovering newer issues and problems and methods of tackling these large complex hernias. I think that's what I have to say, Rahul, if you have anything else. No. Ashwin.
Excellent talk by Dr. Shinde sir and Dr. Mrs. Aparna madam. And it is really wonderful. And we enjoyed this, both the talks and the excellent collection of the cases by Aparna madam. And Shinde sir, as usual, he is fantastic. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.